Hello, this is Marla Dalton, Executive Director and CEO of the National Foundation for Infectious Diseases, or NFID. COVID-19 cases, hospitalizations, and deaths are now beginning to decline in the U.S., and vaccination rates are starting to increase. However, public health experts are concerned about new variants, the possibility of reinfection, and the overall risk of complacency. Joining me today is NFID Medical Director, Dr. William Schaffner, to talk about COVID-19 vaccines, reinfection, and masks. Bill, thanks so much for joining us again today.
Marla, it's always good to be with you. And as with COVID from the beginning, there's always something new.
Indeed. Speaking of which, it appears now that some individuals are taking a wait-and-see approach towards COVID-19 vaccination. So what would you say to those who express concerns about vaccine safety or side effects?
Well, first of all, that kind of hesitancy and wait-and-see is normal. Lots of people are a little bit cautious. After all, COVID is a new virus in the human population, and we've made a new vaccine using new technology rather rapidly. So a degree of caution is to be expected among many folks. But I think I can now reassure them greatly. Think about this. We've now vaccinated more than 30 million people in the United States, and we have a safety surveillance system that's better than for any other vaccine in our history, and no new safety issues have come up. I think I can reassure and indeed comfort people who are hesitant that these vaccines are not only very, very effective, but they are wonderfully safe. Of course, there'll be some side effects, sore arms, and for a varying period of time, a day or two, some proportion of people do get some side effects. They may feel fatigued. Aches and pains they can have, some headache, some chilly sensations some people have, and some people even get a degree of fever. But those side effects are transient. They're gone after 24 or 48 hours. And as I always remind folks, a very small price to pay in order to avoid having to be on a ventilator in an intensive care unit.
Well said. Bill, are there any specific groups who should not be vaccinated against COVID-19?
Well, first of all, we're not vaccinating children yet because the trials, the studies in those children are just underway. And we expect that information, middle of the summer, toward the end of the summer. But children aside, the other group that we're concerned about are people who have had serious allergic reactions, and by that I mean anaphylaxis or some sort of allergic reaction that involves difficulty breathing. Those few individuals should alert the vaccination location that they've had those kinds of side effects before, and they can receive the vaccine, and they may wish to talk about it with their doctor in advance. But as I say, they can receive the vaccine, but they will be monitored for a full half hour after they receive the vaccine. Everyone who's had one of these serious allergic reactions after COVID vaccine has done so within that period of time. Everyone's recovered with appropriate medical care. So that's a very small number of people, but those people should have a degree of caution.
All right. So shifting gears a bit, something we've been reading a lot about is what impact will the new variants have on vaccine effectiveness?
That's something we all want to know, right? Well, our laboratory colleagues are obviously looking at this, and they've told us that so far, all the variants, this British variant, the one from Brazil, and this one from South Africa, which seems to be the most variant of the three, they're all completely or partially covered by our current vaccines. And so we expect our current vaccines, particularly against the British variant, will continue to be very effective. Now, these are more contagious variants. So we have to remember, everybody should keep wearing their masks and doing social distancing, because those measures to interrupt the spread of the virus to ourselves and to others still continue to work.
Okay, on a related note, what do we really know about reinfection? Will natural immunity or current vaccines offer adequate protection against the new variants?
Well, I'm sighing a little bit, because what we really know is at the moment pretty modest. There have been a handful, well, maybe two handfuls, of scientifically rigorously documented second infections. So that number is really very, very small. But I have to tell you that there are patients in my neck of the woods, my community, and others around the country who think they may have been reinfected. And that whole issue now is high on the research agenda of people across the country in academic medical centers and at the National Institutes of Health and the CDC. So how frequently that occurs, we don't know yet. Let's all sit tight. We don't think it's very frequent. How long the vaccines will protect us, obviously, since we've just started vaccinating millions of people, is something that in a rolling fashion will be surveyed by the CDC. At the moment, we're out to a solid 90 days. And then beyond that, some data have just come out to 6 months. All very good so far. So stay tuned. As we learn more about this, we'll let everyone know.
Sounds great. So do individuals who have been fully vaccinated still need to be quarantined if they're subsequently exposed to the virus?
Oh, that's some good news, because the CDC has just recently revised its guidelines. And people who have been fully vaccinated have had two doses. People who also are 2 weeks beyond that second vaccination, those people, if they're exposed to COVID, hooray, do not have to be quarantined. So the CDC really thinks that the protection is pretty solid.
Perfect. Solid. But do vaccinated individuals with one or two doses still need to wear masks?
I'm afraid that that's the answer to that is yes. And for a couple of reasons. The first is, we think at best these vaccines are 95% protective. I didn't say 100%. So for your own safety, you should still wear the mask. And then this issue about whether people can be infected and still infect others, still be contagious, is one that we haven't settled yet. So until we can settle that, we also have to wear masks to potentially protect others around us. So those are two really big reasons. And then there's a third. We still want mask wearing to be the social norm. We would like everybody out there wearing a mask. So if we see some people with masks, some people without, that only creates confusion. So until we get the all clear whistle from the CDC or our state health departments, yes, we should all, even though we're vaccinated, still wear masks and do the social distancing, et cetera, et cetera.
Great. So last question, which is definitely related to the evolving guidance, is do two masks then provide greater protection than just one? Or is it just more important to wear masks properly and consistently?
Well, I'm chuckling. Around here in Middle Tennessee, we're still trying to make sure that everybody wears one and that they wear them correctly above the nose. Wearing the mask only over your mouth with your nose hanging out, that doesn't count. So we're focused on that. Now, more seriously, there are people who would like to get literally another layer of protection. And there are data to suggest now that wearing two masks, a cloth mask first, well fitted around your cheeks and chin, and then with a surgical mask over it, does provide indeed that second layer of protection. Wear them carefully, make sure they're on correctly, and you will find that the work of breathing is a little bit harder when you wear the two masks. Of course, because you're breathing through, in and out, two layers of protection. So see if that's comfortable for you. But if you want to take that extra measure, please go ahead. But my first interest is still getting everybody to wear that single mask.
Great. Bill, thank you, as always, for providing us sound and clear advice. It sounds like the general recommendation is still the same: to mask up, wash your hands, stay socially distanced, and get a vaccine. Anything else, Bill, you'd like to add for the good of the order?
Well, let's all acknowledge that the light is at the end of the tunnel. We can see it, but we will all have to still do these behavioral interventions, the masking, et cetera, and roll up our sleeves to get the vaccine in order for that light to become brighter and brighter. And we anticipate, all things going well, that it may well become very bright toward the end of the summer into the fall. And then maybe we'll get that all clear whistle and we can put our masks aside. And what I hope is we can all do is enjoy at least a near normal Thanksgiving with each other.
It sounds like a wonderful plan. Thanks again, Bill, and thanks to our listeners, and we'll look forward to another update shortly. Take care.
Bye-bye.